everyone to our Monday, April 2nd, 2018 work session of the Linwood City Council here in the City Hall Council Chambers. First off, I'm going to turn the time over real quick to Art Sneza to give us a little information about the mayor and why she's not here at the moment.
Thank you, Council President. Well, as you know, the mayor's been exercising to try to be healthy and well, to be a good role model for all of us. And she thinks she might have pulled something, so she's right now being treated at a facility in Seattle to see what it is. And hopefully we'll see her again very soon.
Excellent. Thank you. So we will go ahead and get started. First, we'll start with item A, or comments and questions on memo items. I did not see any emails. Does anyone have any particular questions about the items there? If not, we'll move on to item B, which is introduction to Linwood Employees Embracing Diversity Committee. Art, if you'll.
Yeah, thank you, Council President and Council members. Item B is an introduction to a new employee committee called the Linwood Employees Embracing Diversity. Acronyms stand for LEED, LEED. A year ago, the council passed a very important resolution, which, among other things, reaffirmed the city's commitment to making the city a safe and welcome place for all residents and all employees. And around that same time, there was a group of employees that had begun meeting to explore the possibility of developing an employee committee that focused on diversity issues. And so I'm very pleased tonight because we have the newly formed committee, which I'm a member, and we have Connie Avalos-Gaylor, who is the committee's chair. And is Robert also here?
Right.
And Robert, oh, there he is, right there. Robert Bartram, who is the vice chair, and Connie is with the police department, and Robert is with the IT department. And so with that, I'd like to turn things over to the chair and vice chair of our new committee.
Good evening, council members. Linwood Employee Embracing Diversity, we are here tonight to introduce ourselves to you. My name is Connie Gaylor, and I am the chair, and Robert Bertram is our vice chair. We officially formed on September 20th, 2017. We approximately have 25 members. We meet on the third Wednesday of each month between noon and 1 p.m. We have between 5 to 15 members that participate monthly. And at this time, I would like lead members to stand up and introduce themselves and state what department they work for.
Yeah, if you'll come on up to the podium as you do that. Thank you.
I'm Leah Jensen. I am with the executive office.
Goya Rivera, Community Development.
Janella Lewis, Budget Coordinator, Finance.
Records.
Corbett Locke, Administrative Services.
Thank you. I would like to introduce Janella Lewis, and she is going to share our mission statement.
Hello, good evening. LEED's mission statement is to cultivate and promote a welcoming, safe, equitable, and inclusive workplace for all employees. Through mutual respect and education, we will achieve our goals of embracing diversity.
Thank you, Janella. I would like to introduce Franz Joslin, who will share the LEED core values.
The LEED core value, we respect the rich and infinite differences of all employees. We demonstrate these values by being a champion to ensure that all employees are able to work in a safe environment of dignity, equity, and inclusion. Thank you.
Going to state a few of our initial goals.
Hello. Even though that we're a young committee, we are aiming to become the Employee Resource Hub for Cultural Understanding. Here are some of our initial goals for our committee. Host fun yet educational workshops on cultural competency for members and other employees. Continue to collaborate with other city committees to create the more employee networking opportunities. We just co-hosted an employee networking event for the Conversation Cafe and the Wellness Committee on March 13th. And also to participate in citywide community projects like the upcoming Clean and Green South Linwood Neighborhood event. Thank you.
To make our city even a better place to work, we would like to ask Council and the Executive Office to continue to support us and help us achieve these goals. Thank you so much.
And Council President, with the Council's permission, we'd like to take a photo with all of you.
All right. Well, now that we're all back from our photo op, thank you for the presentation. And we, I guess I'll take opportunity to speak for the council. We look forward to hearing more about the activities and opportunities that develop from this group. So thank you. Does council have any questions? Yeah. Councilmember Cotton.
Thank you. I just want to encourage you all in what you're doing, and I commend you for taking the extra time and the effort to do it. I would definitely say that, we can do more, and I'm glad that we are. And I love to see the word inclusion in so many of your statements, because diversity is just having a group of different people together, but inclusion is bringing them together. So I'm really excited to see that word in there. So thank you for all the work you do.
Okay, Councilmember Ross.
Yes, thank you all for coming. I, too, look forward to output from your group for us. We're always looking for new ideas and new policies that we can do something with to help encourage this kind of inclusion. So if anything comes up, you know who to call. Ghostbusters.
Councilmember Hurst.
There we go. I just had a question as far as the goal of the committee. Is it more inclusive with employees within the city, or is also outreaching to try to draw in more diverse
employees? It's for all employees for the city, and we're trying to reach out and get resources from community colleges to see what they're doing and see how we can help. Getting resources in for our employees to kind of educate themselves on inclusion, diversity,
you know, just like the Step Up program. You know, we're doing, some of us go to the Edmonds film series that's happening. So those have been very interesting, just to be aware of what's going on and how we can help our employees.
Councilmember Sutton, sorry.
Thank you very much. Additionally to the Step Up program, I would like to encourage all of you, if you have time, on April the 28th, which is a Saturday, the communities of color is also having a conference that you might be interested in taking. It will be over at Edmonds Community College from 8 to 5.
Yes. Thank you. Leah sent us the flyer, and I've sent it out to our lead members already, so hopefully we'll be able to, some of us will be able to attend to that.
Councilmember Frizzell.
I just wanted to add my voice to the thank yous of coming here and getting together on a regular basis. I find that extremely exciting as we watch what the city is doing to include every type, every group of people, every individual, and just knowing that every person makes a difference and every person makes up our community. And just thank you for stepping out and forming a group and coming together to talk about sometimes hard issues. And I'm excited to hear what those conversations are and how we can come alongside and make our city even better. Thank you for being here tonight.
And my preemption, sorry, Councilmember Sessions, Council Vice President Sessions.
Thank you. Could you tell us again when it is you meet?
From noon to 1, and if you would like to come, you certainly may. We have an agenda. You know, we just talk about different things.
And do you meet here?
We meet on Conference Room 4.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thanks for doing this. Good to see you all.
Yes.
Just wanted to add that, as you know, we have a Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Commission as well. And Connie serves as the group's liaison to that commission, has attended every meeting since it started in January.
Excellent. Thank you. Any other comments, questions from council members? All right. Thank you again for the work that you do. And, again, we definitely look forward to hearing what you can accomplish and what you do accomplish. So, all right. And with that, we will move on to item C, Mandatory Responsibilities for a Code City, and I believe Mr. Corbett Locke will be presenting for us.
Yes, while Corbett's getting ready to make a report to the council, as you will recall, the last work session, the council and administration had a follow-up discussion on the council's summit on February 10th, at which time the administration presented its 5 strategic priorities and plan, and Corbett Locke is our point person on developing that plan and monitoring it. And at that time, Council President Goodwin asked a really good question, which was, what are the mandatory responsibilities of a code city? And Corbett has done quite a bit of research on it and is here tonight to present the results of his research.
Great. Thank you. Good evening. So this is a continuation of Council's review of our draft strategic plan and all the other parts that go with this. We started this back on February 10th at your summit, where our directors made presentations to you. And then, as Art just mentioned, at March 21st, we provided responses to the council questions at that time. And now we're here to address the subsequent question that came out of there. So just as a reminder and for our audience, the strategic plan is intended to answer the question, what should be our highest priorities over the next 5 years? And so the 5-year timing is important because there's often externalities or opportunities or influences or limited opportunities that bring things to the front. Certainly all the different things that we do and cover are important, but sometimes there's timing issues that are the tiebreaker there. So the strategic plan will provide guidance to the city, the employees, council, about what will happen over the next 2 bienniums. And so it is a great tool to help us with our budgeting, It's going to make our budgeting process more thoughtful because we're going to be really thinking in a five-year time frame rather than just a two-year time frame as we normally do when we do the budget. So I think it's going to create a new continuity and a greater collective will amongst all of us and bring us all together. So the question that was asked is, what are the things that the city must do? And so that's what I have provided to you in your packet this evening. And there's kind of two ways to address that. One is the more theoretical, what is the absolute minimum mandatory requirements imposed by, say, the state or federal government? So that's part of the answer that you have before you. But to me, that was incomplete in a response because there are other things that we should not ignore. For example, we have employees and we have vehicles. And so to not consider those, I mean, there is no mandate that we have employees. We could contract out every single service that we have and have zero employees. But that just didn't seem useful to you in answering the question. So I tried to approach it with a blend of the hypothetical and the practical as a solution. Linwood is a code city. There's four different classifications of cities in Washington. If you ever cared, I'll mention those quickly to you just for entertainment's sake. Next time you're at an AWC conference, you can share this or ask people what kind of city are you from, and you'll know the answers. But anyway, first-class city, those are, by state law, cities with more than 10,000 population, and they have a charter. Second-class city is more than 1,500 population, and they are not a they don't have a charter, and they do not have they're not a code city. So I'll come back to that last part in just a second. Third type is a town, and so that's a community that incorporates with 1,500 or less population, and coincidentally, there won't be any more of those ever created because they've changed the minimum threshold to incorporate to 1,500, so that will go away eventually as a classification. And then there's the code cities, that's us. So there was a whole section to the revised code of Washington that was added in the 60s because these different classifications created different powers for different cities and it was complicated and hard and one city wanted to do thing another. So they created this optional code city and that's the majority of cities here in Washington state. About 200 of our 282 cities are our code city, so it's the most convenient one. And the other thing that's a determinant here is that this is a mayor-council form of government. You know the other version is a manager-council form of government. So the powers really aren't that much different, but who does the task or who has the assignment is different depending upon which of those apply. There wasn't any good one place I could go to find this list of what are our mandates. And that's really because the legislation is written more about bestowing powers and authorities onto cities based upon their classification rather than saying you must do this or must do that. So those are really more sprinkled amongst topic-specific areas of the state law. And so we try to just summarize them for you. Those begin on page C3 of your packet. I don't want to read each one of these because I don't think you want me to read every one of these, but I will if you like. But we did group them, as was the request, based upon the department or official that has that obligation. And so that's how you see them stratified. Under the administrative or executive department, we have to have a mayor, we have to have a city clerk, we have to have elections for the mayor, and comply with laws like records retention disclosure of public records, and the ADA Act, Americans with Disabilities Act, and sort of just general things that go with administration. Building code, we are responsible for enforcement of the building code, and that's why we have a building division of our community development department, and that's why we have a building official. In terms of the environment, we have to conduct CEQA review. That's the State Environmental Policy Act. That's something that's also done in community development. We have to designate and protect wetlands and prevent a take of an endangered species. So those are areas that we have to do. Finance, we have to adopt a budget. And we have to do that before the beginning of the budget period. So since we have employees, we have to have payroll. And again, that could be contracted out, but that is something that employees appreciate. And we have to have accounting according to adopted procedures. And you've heard about these, the GAAP and the BARS and the GFOA and those kinds of acronyms. Are the standards by which we are expected to account for our funds. And we get audited on that every year, and we have to pay for that audit. So that's not an option. We don't choose to do that. We have to enforce the fire code, and that's why we have a fire marshal. And you remember that when we formed the RFA, that the fire marshal obligation was something that we couldn't give away or hand off, that we still are obligated to do that, and that's why the South County Fire and Rescue provides that service to us under contract. Under judicial, this is I sort of lump these all together. For misdemeanor crimes and offended by an adult, we have to provide for adjudication, and that includes the prosecutor. And indigent defense for qualifying citizens. So that's an obligation for us, and we do have a municipal court. Land use regulations, this comes up a lot before you. You hear about the Growth Management Act. We have to have extensive planning and regulatory work to guide our land use decisions, and we have to approve subdivisions, have a planning agency, and either a hearing examiner or a board of adjustment. And so we have a hearing examiner here as our choice, as you know. There's no mandate that we have legal counsel, but you know, from a practical matter, you have to. It's a matter of business. And so we do need to do that to be able to respond to claims and to give guidance and all the different things that an attorney is important for. Most important is a legislative, so we have to have 7 council members. And that requires elections. You have to meet at least once a month. And those meetings are open to the public and subject to the Open Public Meetings Act. So you all know about that. So you are an important role here. And next is law enforcement. State law says we must have a chief law enforcement officer. That's all it says. So we presume that means that we're supposed to have some level of law enforcement activity, which we do. It doesn't say how much you have to have. So that's a local decision. And then we also need to take care of the obligation for either detention or corrections imposed by the judicial system for those misdemeanor crimes. We don't have a state law that says we must take care of our fleet, but it sure seems to make sense that we do that. Just like at home, if you're going to invest in something, you should take care of it. So to me, that's not something to not have if you have a fleet. We have no requirement to have streets, which is interesting to me. According to the law, but in a practical matter, every jurisdiction has streets. They build them, they maintain them, they provide law enforcement, traffic enforcement, maintain the signals, they Cities are obligated to manage the stormwater that comes off their streets. So in every way other than the actual wording in the revised municipal code, we have to have streets, and we do provide them. Technology, again, there's no requirement that we have computers and phones, but in this day and age, it'd be pretty hard for us to get our job done, going back to just paper and pen. So to me, computers are a mandatory thing. And then since we do have utilities, there are things that go along with that, like adopting the rates and complying with environmental regulations that go with it. So that's my take on what is required at a general high level, and I hope that's useful. If I miss the mark, let me know, and we'll go back to it. But we try to respond to that request so that you can continue your work in reviewing the draft strategic plan. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. Looks like we do have some questions, if you're open to answering what you can.
You bet.
All right. Councilmember Cotton.
So, thank you, sir. And thank you, Corbett, for being here tonight. Just as a, by way of reference, was most of this in the RCW that's like 35A or whatever it is for, or did you find that you had to kind of connect the dots, so to speak? And if so, what did you find as kind of resources that you were able to draw from?
Well, the first stop was the Municipal Research and Services Center. The first question is, has somebody already asked and answered this question? So being efficient, we wanted to benefit from that. And they had not had this exact question posed to them. So they did help with a response. You're right that the majority of the regulations that apply to Linwood are in Title 35A. That's the optional municipal code. And so most of them are there, but they are sprinkled all over in other areas. And so I didn't try to provide every citation, in part because some of these are inferred, like streets. I mean, you have to have streets. But, yeah, there was no one place to go to.
No, thank you. I appreciate that, kind of just that that backup information. So, thank you. Great presentation. This, I think I actually learned a couple things, which is great. So thank you.
You're welcome.
Any other questions, comments? One thing that I would ask, just if you have it available, any of the things that you saw, if you have this in like a spreadsheet or an Excel sheet or something, where you can just quickly put an asterisk by anything that was mandatory, like that specifically stated, just so when I look at it, I can say, okay, this is a very specific thing, because I know, like,
yeah, I have that.
Okay,
yes.
So if you could send that to us, that'd be fantastic. I mean, all of this is excellent, and I think, you know, one of the things that you mentioned, we're not required to have streets, but in essence, I mean, really, we are required. It's not something we cannot do. And then I guess my assumption would be, if we have those, then these are the things that are expected. All the things that you have listed here, right? If we have streets, that we maintain them, that we provide for, you know, whatever it is, comply with Washington State Department of Transportation requirements and all that kind of stuff. Yeah, other than that, thank you very much. I appreciate the work that you put in to bring this forward and give us an idea more, I think, at least from my personal perspective, what I was looking for, just like this, is what is it that we as a city have a responsibility to provide that we can specifically point to in budgeting for outcomes, right? The very basics that we need to make sure that we have for our citizens as we prepare for doing this budgeting. What are those things that we want to make sure are there and funded and complete? So this list does that for me. It shows that information. So I appreciate that. Yeah.
I appreciate that very much. And you know, one thing I would just add is as you consider this, it is really important because these are mandates, right? And you will see all of these different mandates addressed in our budget proposal. They always are because this is what we do. And so many of these are ongoing and not second nature, but they are things that are sort of assumed or a given for us, like the protection of wetlands. We have very thorough regulations. We have a permitting process and a review process and scientific standards, and we follow the letter of the law, if not exceed it. And it works really well, and it is mandatory, but it isn't necessarily, from the director's standpoint, our highest priority in the next 5 years. And that's where the distinction is that this is great background information, but ultimately it's our choices about not just doing the mandatory, but also what are our strategic and our smartest choices that we have available to us.
Thank you. And in my view, something like that, where you have, you know, environmental protections and things like that, those are, as you said, the ongoing things, you know, something we look at in a way, kind of take for granted, but something we look at each time we do a project or each time we do something. That's one of those things that comes to the forefront is, you know, if we're building here or if we're doing something that will disturb the wetlands, you know, what are the protections that are offered and that kind of thing. So thank you. I appreciate that. Any other questions, comments, concerns? Yeah, please, Councilmember Hurst.
I was just thinking a new thing for today. Most of this is state. I mean, I know this is maybe going into the weeds, but federal mandates, you know, like, I mean, I don't know. I can't remember. I think the ADA would be a federal mandate, wouldn't it? Or has the state adopted the?
There's two layers of mandates. One is the Americans with Disabilities Act, which is federal regulation, applies to all states and territories. And then in Washington, we have the, I think it's called the Barrier Free Act or chapter of the building code that has a lot of those same items and, in fact, some additional ones.
Okay. Yeah, because I was just curious as to, you know, what federal mandates, if any, we have to face. I don't know if I want you to keep on having to study that, to be honest, now that I've asked the question. But it's just something to think about, that we do have some responsibility on that, too.
Well, yes, there are, and I didn't try to unpeel this all the way down to the fine-grained details, and I'm happy to do that if that's what you would like. Things like the Clean Water Act is a federal regulation. We have to comply with that, with our discharges from the wastewater treatment plant. American Civil Liberties Act involves workplace conditions, and we have employees, so we have to comply with that, and those kinds of things come to mind.
All right, thank you. Anything else? Excellent. Thank you, thank Mr. You. Locke. I appreciate the information. All right, so with that, we can move on to item D, Ordinance Franchise Agreement with AT&T for Communication Facilities. So if those that are involved with that would come up and...
Karen Fitchum, our procurement manager, Drew Burnett, our IT director, and Bill Friends, our public works director.
Right,
thank
welcome.
You for making yeah. some time for us tonight. We don't actually have a forward presentation for you. What we have noticed is that the last few franchises we've brought forward associated to telecommunications have generated quite a bit of interest from the council. So what we wanted to do this time through with our new AT&T franchise here tonight was to give you an opportunity to have that question and answer period in a more live session rather than the email version that we've been going through for the last couple of franchises. And as Art pointed out, we have the Public Works Director, Bill Franz, here, as well as Drew Burnett, our IT director, because they were two of the primary individuals and their departments that worked to finish this in a way that would meet all the needs of the city, as well as AT&T as our franchisee here. So unless you guys have something else you wanted to mention, we'll just turn it over to you guys for questions.
Do we have any specific questions? Yes, please, Councilmember Cotton.
Thank you, Council President, and thank you for bringing the big guns tonight. So just a couple questions as I was going through this. So somebody go ahead and throw a boot at me or use the crooked stick with, if you need to pull me off the stage. First is on page D5 under term of franchise. On line 33, the term of the franchise shall be a period of 10 years. Is that a pretty standard, like, term of a franchise agreement? Is that kind of a WAG number? How do we land on 10? If it's an industry standard, I'm good with that. I don't know.
Well, that's a good way to put it. What is the industry standard? So what we've found in the franchises that we've been dealing with is that many of them were originally set up for 50 years or 25 years or decades. And that might serve really well when you have a utility that's pretty predictable. Pipes, great, yeah. Water, things that we know are going to continue pretty much in the same vein for a long period of time. But when we looked at this and we've looked at cable, telecommunications, fiber, et cetera, over the last 20 years we've seen an explosion in change. And we kind of anticipate that we'll see even more in the next. So rather than put this down for a 25, 35, or 50-year period, we felt it more appropriate to find something a little shorter.
Okay, excellent. Thank you for that. And I'm glad to hear that we're tooling this a little bit more specific for the technology. The next question is just more, and thank you, Director Franz, for being here, because this is kind of maybe more of a question for you on page D8. On the very bottom there, line 41, it's under the maintenance and restoration. I'm thinking more about right our roads, right? When we go through and we repave a beautiful street and then, you know, PSU, somebody else wants to come through and go, oh, I'm glad you repaved that 18 months ago. We need to tear it all up again. I'm seeing here that, I know it never happens. It's like, a brand new road. Great, let's go trench it. And I know that that's just, you know, that is what it is. But when we talk about maintenance and restoration here, we're talking about them warranting their work for 2 years. Does that feel like a good term for the kind of thing that they're going to be impacting?
That is the standard type of duration for that kind of warranty.
Okay.
And for this kind of work, I'd expect a lot less impact, at least on the public work stuff. You know, they may cut a sidewalk, may trench a road, but it's most likely going to be above ground stuff that I anticipate they're going to be doing. So I think this is adequate.
Okay, excellent. And then last one, and then I'll relinquish the floor, and thank you all for your patience. It's on thank you. It's on page D15. Under section 4.1, which is the recovery of costs, which is our favorite topic to discuss. Line 3, we're talking about the franchise agreement being $2,500, which has been pretty boilerplate for these agreements. As we've been talking about the small cell and some other topics, which kind of, as you've been very wise to bring forward this to discuss prior to, that this has kind of perked our interest as a council, I think, or several of us. The realization that we have, you know, a substantial portion of infrastructure that requires employees to, you know, anytime a franchisee wants to disturb or change anything that we have in order to do what they want to do, that takes effort. But it seems to me that the fees for permits really kind of cover a lot of that. Is that the thought of city staff too, that the burden of staff time to manage a lot of this happens more in the permit fees than it does in the franchise agreements?
I can address the portion that you're referring to here.
Okay.
So we are limited in the way that we can recoup the costs that it takes for us to develop a franchise like this. So we've done what we can to make them standardized, but nonetheless, we spend months negotiating these, and the white, as you can see, they're fairly complex documents. We do have to give them a demonstration of what these charges would be and be standard in the way that we do this. We're not able to add any other fees or charges to telecommunications under state law. We're very limited in how we can do so. So where you see the large franchise fees or cable access, that sort of thing, where it's considered to be more optional for folks, whereas telecommunications is considered to be a primary important utility for our citizens. So we're not allowed to use the franchise fee of a percentage of their sales. We're very limited in the way that we can do this, and this has been a standard for just the documentation fees alone. And I will tell you flat out, it doesn't come even close to representing the administrative costs and the legal costs of negotiating one of these at all. I can show in the first couple of months of our work on these that we've expended that just in Rosemary's time alone.
No, absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
If I heard the question of Paul Krause, Community Development Director. And I was in the middle of the New York Times crossword when I heard something about permit fees.
Sorry, Paul.
And since I was stumped anyway, I just wanted to assure you that we our permit fees are charged separately. Virtually all these projects, improvements, require either electrical permits or mechanical permits. Or grading permits, or I mean, there's all kinds of permit, and those permit fees generate enough revenue to cover the cost of issuance and inspection. So that's sort of a standalone issue, and really shouldn't be part of the franchise discussion itself.
Okay, I'm wondering if, as we are doing more of the budgeting for outcomes, you know, and we are talking about kind of, you know, at least being able to have the discussion about how much we want development to pay for the permitting and everything that it takes to actually do the development. I'm wondering if the discussion wouldn't be worth having, and this is for you guys to have, this isn't for us, but to have that discussion maybe amongst yourselves about that, the burden to develop those, you know, agreements and all the stuff to get to where they are permitting. Does it make sense to at least understand what that cost is, and is there a way to recover that through the permit, or is that maybe, are those two things separate, or?
Permitting, the cost for building permits and other development permits, there is RCW that gives guidance towards that. And you're really supposed to use them to cover the cost of plan review, issuance, and inspection.
Okay.
The end.
So you can't burden it with administrative costs to...
Other well, just stuff. The administrative cost of issuing the permit, not gotcha. The franchise agreement. So.
Okay. All right. Thank you. I'll relinquish the floor. Thank you all.
Councilmember Ross.
So, Karen, I assume this dollar amount is set somewhere in state law. Is there anything we can do to...
I'll double-check on that. I know that we received that as the appropriate amount from Rosemary. So I'll double-check whether it's actually set in law or not.
I just wondered if that was something we could stick on a legislative list somewhere about maybe approaching the state folks about easing that, because it's not money out of their pocket.
I know I've got it in my notes from her somewhere. I just can't recall right now. That's but I'll double check it, yeah, and let you guys know.
Let's see.
Yes, Councilmember Hurst.
Well, I think isn't this just basically a boilerplate of what we've done for, I forget the name of the company that really does the work for Sprint. We just did that.
Mobility?
Yes, thank you. And we charged them the same thing, and I regretted that, but we couldn't change it. And so I'm assuming we have to charge the same thing for all the folks that come in, the wireless folks that come in now.
That was our intention when we set the boilerplate, same for everybody.
Okay.
Did you have a comment?
Yeah, just one thing that I will say is that
as we've done a boilerplate, yes, there's still a lot of negotiation that happens, but the good news is it's kind of, we've gotten pretty good at it, you know. So the efficiencies and such are built in. Karen's done a wonderful job of trying to get us in and get us all together and make sure that we're on the same page. And going forward, these have gotten a lot easier. So.
Excellent. A question that I have on page D6, talking about the use of rights of way. And it says on lines 16 and 17, if the city in its reasonable judgment determines that any portion of the franchisee's facilities is an undue burden, the city shall provide notice to franchisee, and then it goes on. Is there in the code or somewhere set what exactly an undue burden is for the city? And I wouldn't expect that they're going to have a list of things, because that could be exhaustive, or maybe they couldn't exhaust the list, but do we have some ideas of kind of what that means for us as a city?
That's always one of the difficult parts of wording these kinds of phrases, because it puts a significant requirement on us to make sure that when we make that reasonable judgment, I'm surprised you didn't jump out on the word reasonable, because that's the other one that people often jump out on. Who decides what's reasonable, mm-hmm. and what is an undue burden? And to be honest with you, in the real world, 90% of this gets dealt with, maybe 99%, simply by communicating with each other. They let us know what's going on, or we let them know there's a problem with something. We work it out. We resolve it. One franchisee needs something from another franchisee, and we've got to negotiate these. So in the real world, most of it gets worked out in a very simple way. When it gets down to deciding what's reasonable and what's an undue burden and what's not an undue burden, if you're past that 99%, it's the lawyers who end up deciding what that is. And unfortunately, that's something that's not simple to write into a clause. I'd like to be more clear, but that's my understanding.
Well, and there'd be professional judgment. If, let's say, they put something up that caused a site distance issue, something like that could be measured and fixed accordingly, or if it's something created some kind of hazard. But other than that, I think it's just going to be professional judgment until, as Karen said, until it gets to the point of real legalities.
Have we had many issues or complaints with the way that things have been set up through these contracts in the recent few months, or maybe even last year or two, that you can recall? No. Okay.
None that I'm aware of.
All right. Any other questions, comments? Anything else that you have for us?
I was just going to make a comment. Just thank you for coming here. I mean, we've talked about this several different times with different groups now and in different ways and things through email as well. And it's been put in quite the package. We have the different views of all the different angles it could be. And so... thank you for doing that.
Yes, please.
My question would be, shall we move this to the consent agenda for? No, it won't be consent because they have to vote. It's an ordinance, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So it's okay to move it forward to the business session next week. Okay, great.
All right. Thank you. All right, so we have executive session coming up. What do you think the time frame for that will be, roughly?
I think if we start with 20 minutes, perhaps, it's probably going to go a little longer than that, but it's probably a good guess.
Okay, if we're going 20 minutes, do we need a break before we head in there? A little break? So what we'll do, we will move into executive session for property acquisition and potential litigation, 196 project, for 20 minutes. That will begin, we'll say, at 8 o'clock, so it'll give us just under 10 minutes to go in there. Yes.
Should we go ahead if there's any special counsel comments that need to be said so that we can adjourn after this? Is anybody want to bring – is that okay to do that now and then we can adjourn afterwards? Or
Yeah, I think we'll come back in before we adjourn.
We will?
Yeah.
Okay.
So we'll go back in there, and that will commence at 8 p.m. for 20 minutes, unless an extension is needed. Thank you. All right, we are back at 8:35 p.m. And are there any council comments or questions or announcements that need to be made? If not, I have one that I would like to make just about our discussion earlier. We were talking about the Code City, the responsibilities of the Code City, that kind of thing. I want to keep that in mind because I would like to, at the next work session, have a discussion about the budgeting for outcomes process on the council side. So take a look at the priorities that the administration gave to us, some of the things that we've talked about, but what is it that you as council members or we as a council are looking for in our budgeting for outcomes? I think most specifically, what are the outcomes that we're looking for? What are the specific things that we as a council want? And then we can discuss how we want or how we can mesh those in with what it is that the administration has provided as well. Yes.
Just on that topic, do you have an idea how you're planning on kind of maybe structuring that discussion? Or is it just going to be kind of around Robin? Or is there going to be some kind of quantifiable?
It'll be... more of a round robin where, and that's why I'm trying to bring it up now, so that you'll have a few weeks to think of some ideas, things that you're looking at, or priorities that you think that we should push toward as a council or as a city, you know, as a city as a whole, by way of funding mechanisms or specific things to fund, what we should fund, or how we see adjusting the programs that we have now, where do we see the funding kind of going? So, for instance, in my mind, I'm thinking, for instance, streets, right? We have a lot of street repairs, things that need to be done with the streets. Do we continue with TBD funding and add to that more funding from the general fund? Do we dispense with doing TBD stuff or lower that and put more from general fund into street? How do we as a council see that funding mechanism working, right? And with other programs that we have.
So just to that point, maybe if are you planning on as part of that cover page, maybe kind of outlining maybe the process a little bit? I'm just, you know, because I might prepare for this completely differently than, you know,
yeah,
others.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I don't want to be too in the weeds or too high level. I want to be Goldilocks port.
Yeah, and the goal is not to be in the weeds.
Okay.
Because the funding is the policies, right? That's what our responsibility is, the policy part of that. How the directors direct those funds that the mayor appropriates and that we approve, That's for them, right? It's not for us to dictate how Director Swordell puts the money into the parks. But what do we want to see in that area that we can show, you know, Director Swordell, this is what we've heard from the community, or these are the ideas that we have of things that need to be, or that we have placed great importance on funding. So, you know, in public works, in the parks department, in economic development, you know, those kind of things. And with that being said, when we look at economic development, for instance, we've heard that at times Director Krause has mentioned, right, the need for more bodies being able to do some of that stuff. That, I don't want to get into that discussion with us because that's something for them to bring to us. and say, you know, this is what we need. If that's the case, this is what we need, or this is where a priority is for us. And we'll see that as those projects come forward when we're looking at the ST3 project, right, and the development and the things that come along there. They may need more bodies, and that's what they'll bring forward, saying in order for us to support it, like we've said, this is what we'll need. So we'll wait for the administration's needs on those items. But for us, what do we see as a council that we want to bring forward as priorities that we can mesh with the administration and work together on those things to push those forward, if that makes sense? Yes. Yes. All right. Okay. Any other questions, comments?
I have a comment.
Okay.
I just wanted to thank you for the initiative to have Corbett create that document, because that solidified a lot of things for me as far as, okay, this is what we're mandated to do. This is what we need to do, have to do. It's not, golly gee, we should, we could, if only. And so just thank you for asking for that, because it really clarified a lot of things for me to have that in one document.
Good. Well, thank you. That was the intention, is for us to have, because I know that we could, each in the time that we have free, do some of that same research, but I don't know that we would have got the same things and had the same ideas from someone that works with each of those departments and works within that realm. So that was one of the big reasons that I had asked them to do that. So, and thanks for those that were willing to sponsor that and move it forward. Anything else? If there is nothing else, I'll call for adjournment.
So moved.
All in favor?
Aye.
All right, we're adjourned. Thank you.